IRTS Live is brought to you by United Players. It takes the hood to save the hood. Lifelong Medical Care, offering free vaccines for everyone 12 and over. Call Lifelong at 510-549-5454 or visit lifelongmedical.org. This episode is powered by plushlifemedia.com. Let us remix your digital presence. Hey, we've got gear. Visit IRTSshow.com for coffee cups, caps, t-shirts, and just added IRTS Live mouse pads and personal protective masks. Founded by our own Ryan Nicole, check out Haven, a cultural media production and distribution initiative for housing justice. Find out more at havenprojectoakland.com. Join DJs Big Russ and CJ Flash for the world-famous show live Fridays, noon to 4 Pacific. Catch them on the following social media platforms. And if you'd like to join us as a sponsor, please email us at info@irtsshow.com.
What's going on? You got the almighty DJ CJ Flash back with a brand new episode, a live episode that is, of I Remember That Song. And here to tell you all about it is the man, the myth, the legend, Mr. Jerry Dove.
CJ Flash, my friend.
Dominus Ominous.
Wait a minute. I'm going to get to that in a second. I learned something this week with that heat wave that we had out here. I learned that I really need to get my act together because I will not do well in hell. Dominus Ominous.
You're not going to do well in here.
No, it's too high. Just too high.
Brother, it's hot where we came from. Believe that.
Well, I might live in Monterey or something like that, you know. But anyway. That joke only had one tag on it, brother. You put another tag on that joke, and I didn't know where to go with it. So look. Where your face at? Let me see CJ there. We got a great show tonight. Wait. And there's the dog.
It's so great. Speedy. Somebody is excited.
He said, you're not going to leave me out. You don't put Speedy in the corner.
Live television, folks. Obviously, I didn't feed him enough before the day started. But anyway, as I was saying, hi to everybody. Let me say hello, first of all, to Tracy Anderson, the CEO of Plush Life Media. What's up,
Tracy? Hey, I'm good. How are you, sir?
I'm doing just fine. All that means is somebody's coming to the door. My dog alarm has set it off.
Happy Tuesday to you.
And to you as well. You looking good? Feeling good?
I'm great. I'm doing well. Thank you.
Okay. Then let's carry on and talk to our friend Ryan Nicole up in Ryan again with the IRTS Live backdrop. I love that.
Damn. You can't lose with that, can you? Look at that.
Not at all. I love it. How you doing? You
good? I'm good. I'm happy to be here. Glad to be doing the show once again.
I appreciate you being here. Big Russ.
Yes, sir.
One half of the world famous, been playing music in the Bay for over 25 to 30 years. He's a t-shirt guru. I see something about Blue Note on there. Let's see what you got today, Blue.
Blue Note.
Uh-huh. Blue Note. Love that. You feeling good?
I am. I'm literally just ran in the door. I had a day with my mom today. We went to the movies for the first time in 16 months.
Wow. What did you go see?
Fast and Furious 12.
You took your mom.
Was that your mom's choice?
I want to go see Vin Diesel.
Okay, mom.
I can't blame her.
Mike Douglas used to make me more.
Would you be talking about Miss Gabriel like that? I know Miss Gabriel.
Suffering.
Wow, that's funny, man. That's funny.
See, I have no threat here. She cannot get on the Book of Faces, so I know she could. Okay.
All right, so we both need to get together so we don't end up in where it's hot. But one last hello to the DJ, the almighty CJ Flash, the music director of IRTS Live, the music director of What's Your Jam. He's wearing his Philadelphia International shirt. I was going to wear one of mine too, but I thought you might, and then we look all twinsy, so I didn't want to do that. So,
well, hey, that's all right. I'll rep.
You got it, brother. You got it. All right, so look, we got a great guest tonight. Y'all ready to hear about her?
Yes.
Yes.
IRTS Live welcomes Miss Dyana Williams. She's a longtime radio and TV personality. We don't, you know, out here on the West Coast, unfortunately, we don't get to see that radio magic they have back east and down south. So some of you may only know her from her work on Unsung, but trust me, she's been in radio for a long time and does her thing, and she's a legend back there. Dyana Williams is also known as the Godmother of Black Music. Yes. She's on the board and co-chair of the Natural Museum of African American Music in Nashville. You can check that out at blackmusicmuseum.org. And like I said, she's the Godmother of Black Music Month, which happens to be June, which means that right now is Black Music Month, which is one of the many reasons we wanted to have this beautiful, dynamic woman on the show. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, say hello to Dyana Williams. Woo-hoo.
Welcome! Oh. Beautiful introduction, and I want to send love to my sisters, Tracy and Ryan Nicole.
Hey, bless you.
I want to shout out Big Ross and DJ Flash.
Yes.
What's up, Sam?
What about me? What about me?
No, not,
what
about not me? You. Not you.
What about me?
Not you. No.
I said, thank you for that introduction.
Oh, yeah, you're right. I'm sorry. Yes, I just wanted to hear you say it twice. I just wanted to hear you say it twice.
He had to say it twice.
That's right.
Like DJ dancer, right? Old school DJ.
It's a Capricorn in me. What can I tell you? You know?
I'm not mad at you.
Listen.
There you go.
Again, I spent a little time in radio myself, and so, but strictly on the West Coast, and I only knew about you really from Unsung. And nowadays, that you can listen to music online, you can sit here in Bay Area and listen to any station in the country that you want, which we didn't have for a while there. But tell us and tell all these people a little bit about your radio background, if you would, please.
Well, I am a native New Yorker. I was born in Queens, raised as a small child in the Bronx, and as a teenager in Harlem, my beloved community that really shaped and molded me as a young woman and exposed me on a larger level to Black music in a myriad of ways. When I was a teenager, I was hanging out in the jazz clubs, the Village Vanguard, all through the Village, and even uptown, Birdland, you name it.
Wow.
I was 19. But it's all good because I was dating when I was 17, turning 18, a jazz musician named Hubert Laws, who took me everywhere.
Oh, okay.
My relationship with Hubert, I visited Rudy Van Gelder's studios in Jersey, where his label mates on the CCI label were Hank Crawford, Esther Phillips, Grover Washington Jr., Freddie Hubbard, First Light. Then, of course, the great work that Hubert did with Afro Blue and the rest of the albums that he did during his tenure. So as a young woman, and this was my first love, he said, you have a great voice and you should do radio. Hubert was the first person to encourage and identify my voice as a core capacity to be on the radio. And a gentleman named Van Jay did my first air check that got me my job. Van Jay was the overnight DJ at WRBR, which was our straight ahead jazz station in New York at the time, and we're talking the early 70s, we're talking 1972, 3 at this point. But I was offered a position by Bob Nighthawk Terry at WHUR 96.3 in DC when it was Chocolate City. And I did a show there called Ebony Moonbeams for a period of time until Frankie Crocker, who is the dean of Black radio, called me and offered me several jobs in different markets, first St. Louis, then Chicago, and finally the one that I said yes to, which was WBLS in New York, my hometown. And I was a college dropout, so I dropped out to do radio in D.C. Wow. So that's the beginning. That's the 70s, and then in the 80s, I was at WBAS pretty much throughout the 80s. During the heyday of the Sound of Philadelphia as well. And then I went on to be a program director at Magic 102.3 in DC. I did Morning Drive. I am not a Morning Drive there. And I was music and program director and also ran WOL. And I was Wendy Williams' boss.
Oh.
For a slight period of time. Those of you who may have seen the Wendy Williams Lifetime movie. Hmm. she and I have two different recollections.
No surprise there. Yeah.
Who did they have play you in that movie?
You know, I don't know the young lady's name, but it was an interesting thing because in the film, she's called Dyana Williams. Mm-hmm. But when you see the spelling of her name on the door, it's the way my government checks look like when I got the stimulus, okay? Mm-hmm. It's Dyana. So, but anyway, that was the 80s. And then the 90s, I continued to do radio and worked at VH1, BET. So I've done television and radio concurrent throughout my entire career.
Wow.
My last full-time radio job was last year, and that was at WRNB Classic 107.9. And I did an afternoon drive show where we played classic soul music.
Wow.
Yeah.
All right, we're all going to take a breath here and then recap. Recap some of that stuff that you said here. Hubert Laws.
Wow.
Not a bad first boyfriend. Not a bad one
at all. That's great.
WHUR, not a bad radio gig.
The home of the quiet storm.
Yes. Kathy
Hughes.
Jeez. Kathy Hughes, not a bad best friend.
Yeah.
Not a bad best friend. Love her.
All right. Let me let the other team jump in and see what you guys heard during all that.
Absolutely.
BET, VH1, Freddie Hubbard. The village, the whole village. And, I mean, come on. I'm just sitting here drooling. Your career is goals for real.
Yeah.
It was the radio and TV concurrent for me. I'd like to be able to do that, you know, at the same time is amazing.
Yeah.
And produce, and later for the last 27 years, I've been doing artist development with an emphasis on media coaching. So that company where I'm CEO, Influence Entertainment, I've worked with a couple of artists in all genres. Country, the Zac Brown Band, to Rihanna, Justin Bieber, just all that. Charlie Wilson, one of my favorites.
Mm.
And athletes as well. I just worked with Carmelo Anthony not long ago.
Wow.
So a plethora of celebrities, high profile, emerging as well as established individuals.
She worked with Justin Bieber on his first record, before his first record, and Rihanna before her first record. Because I worked with them at Island Def Jam, and they needed it. And she came through. We have just heard a lot about it, but she is not blowing her own horn at all. If I was to go and talk about all her accolades and all the people, all the careers that she has touched, we'd have two or three shows. I can't wait for you, for Ebony. This is the battle I want. Ebony Moonbeam versus CJ Flash. That's the battle I want.
I'm messing with CJ. I'm not messing with CJ. Super knowledgeable, very talented. But I think we could go a few rounds. I'm spurred.
Yeah, you will.
There's a couple of people from the Bay Area that I believe you worked with on the artist development piece, which is Kayla. And Sweetie. So how was, were you supporting Kehlani through some of her challenging times? I mean, I have a vested interest in her just because I went to school with her mom and her aunt. So to know that someone like you, you know, has been in her corner, just helping her adjust to this new life, you know, is very comforting.
Yeah, thank you for sharing that. I did work with Kalani some years ago. It was in the very beginning of her recording situation at Atlantic. And so when I worked with her, we did a couple of sessions. Everything seemed pretty quiet in her life. It was the beginning, though. It was very, you know, I had a conversation with a client today about what happens to a person when they are no longer obscure and they become well known and they can't walk down the street without being recognized. I mean, mm-hmm. I tackle this conversation with my clients because oftentimes they go from being unknown to being well known, and it can happen really fast. A hit record, you know that, all of you. It can happen very quickly. And there's something to be said. We all want it for a minute, that recognition. It feels good when you walk down the street and say, hey, yeah, it's Big Rocks. Yeah, I know you. Oh, yeah. Hey, Ryan Nicole. However, but if you out with your man or your special somebody and you try to have that moment and people keep coming up to you wanting autographs, wanting pictures, whatever, you know, some people get real indignant if you say no.
Right.
You know, you are entitled, even when you're a public person, to a modicum of privacy. And yes, so I talked to my clients about that. And I want to shout out Jana Fleischman of Big Rock when you mentioned, because she hired me to work with both Justin Bieber and Rihanna and was present for those sessions and also hired me to work with Neo and a plethora of artists that were on the roster at that time. And also Laura Swanson, I have to give her a high five and a shout out because she was one of the white publicists, head of publicity at the time, along with Sheila Richmond, who was still at Atlantic Records. I credit Sheila Richmond in a huge way for crossing me over to white artists, you know? And not that that was ever my goal, because I am blackity black black and love people, all due respect to my fellow human beings who are not black. But these white women, as well as Jana Fleischman, who is at Roc Nation with Jay-Z still to this day. But even she hired me to do Nicole Buss, who I was, it's great to work with an artist whose music you really like.
Love her.
Story, so. I stopped there.
Wow. Can I ask a question?
Sure, go ahead.
I just want to ask a question.
I'm sorry, Tracy. And sweetie, I love a smart woman, and she is very smart. She's very clever. Mm-hmm. She's got great ideas. She is very connected. The last time I worked with her, we did a piece on Remember All the Oppression in Nigeria. And Marley, who's also one of my clients, they did a Facebook Live or something. And she and I prepped for that. She does her homework, very smart. You know that she's a graduate. I want to say USC, might be USC, but love working with smart women like Sweetie.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Thank you for contributing, you know, on so many levels. My God.
So much my honor, for real. Yeah. I love talking to young women, young black women as well. And Latina, I'm Puerto Rican. I'm Afro Latina. So.
Puerto Rico.
Hey. Oh.
Yes.
Ryan, go ahead, Ryan.
Jerry's got a question in here. Jerry's like, hello.
No, I'm just going with the flow. I'm letting my team talk to you. We're having a conversation. This is not an interview. This is a chat. We're sitting in, around talking about music and what it means to us. That's all we're doing here.
That's what we
go ahead, Ryan.
I just wanted to ask, what does artist development entail? Like, if there were five pillars of artist development that you say have been necessary and consistent through the years, what is it?
Well, I would say the pillars are, and I'm not giving them to you in order. First of all, public persona, the development of one's public persona, the messaging that you share regarding your creativity, whether it is a book, a movie, an album, whatever it is, being very clear on who you are. In journalism and the things that I address with all of my clients is who, what, where, when, why, and how. So that's the basics of communications. And we enter from that point. And then we do deeper dives into who are you? What do you think? How do you feel? What is this project about? Like, I had a client today, really talented young man from Los Angeles. And I was like, what do you stand for? He's like, I want people to have an immersive experience. And I was like, whoa, what? Okay. I got a really smart one here, and I got a really developed artist who had a strong sense of his artistry and creativity. Personality. What everybody, there are 8 billion people on this planet right now, give or take. People are dying at this moment and people are being born. However, we are all uniquely ourselves. And so part of what I do with my clients is, what makes you special? Let's focus and put a light and shine on your unique individuality. Even though you may sound like another artist or maybe even look like another artist, you are yourself. Mm-hmm. Like no two snowflakes are the same. So those are, I would say, some of the pillars. And I stand on the shoulders of Mrs. Maxine Powell, who did artist development at Motown with Berry Gordy. I actually flew to Detroit at one point, and I had the honor of sitting by her feet.
Wow.
Speaking to Mrs. Powell, and she was guarded at first. She was like, who's this chick? Right. The person who introduced us told her that I did similarly to what she did, but Mrs. Powell did more human etiquette with like which fork, how to sit, how to stand. I don't do that. Mm-hmm. I don't talk about posture or, for instance, if you're a lady, don't sit with your legs wide open, even if you have pants. That is not a good message to send in terms of body language. So we talk about body language. We talk about human messaging and human connection. That's what we do. But Mrs. Powell, at the end of the evening, blessed me up. And she said, Miss Williams, you're very smart and dressed. And I said, thank you very much, Mrs. Powell. Pleasure meeting you. And then Suzanne DePauw.
Wait, can I interject real quick since we're talking about fashion? We got to talk about your earrings since we brought up fashion here.
Yeah.
It took me a minute to figure out, that was her earrings. It's not like some kind of collar on her jacket. Those are nice.
You're beautiful.
Yeah. It's actually denim, Jared.
Yeah, wow.
Lovely designer here in Philadelphia. And you know, it's interesting because I bought several pair and I gave away the other pairs to some of my female artists because they admired them. So nice.
Those are beautiful.
Had to bring that up. Now, please.
Yeah, you were going to say, you were going to make mention of Suzanne DePass, who I just admire. I have a few people that I really admire. One is Dyana Williams, Kathy Hughes. Okay. And then this powerhouse that you're going to speak about as well. So please, definitely.
See, you and I have similar tastes.
Yes.
High regard for the women that you just mentioned. Suzanne DePass took over where Mrs. Powell left off with Motown when the Jackson 5 were signed. And she did their artist development, handheld, you know, everything. I mean, and it encompasses, you know, back to your question, Ryan Nicole, about what are the pillars, what is entailed. There's so much more. I mean, I can't begin to tell you how many times I had a client this weekend, I will not name her, but she was having a bit of a meltdown about an interview that she had to do where she didn't feel like she had a real handle on the subject matter. It was heavy subject matter. It was political, it was a lot of movement, it was a lot. And she didn't want to feel, she's very smart and passionate, but she wanted to go over, and the message I got from the publicist was, she only wants 10 minutes of your time. Because I was really, really busy, and I said, she's got it. And so oftentimes my clients will call me if they want to flesh through current events, discuss serious matters. You know, when I worked with Meek Mill, we would sit and talk about the criminal injustice.
Yes.
Of course, we see where he is now with it. I worked with him through that. I testified.
Wow.
On his behalf before the judge that was keeping him imprisoned in, you know, his situation. So anyway, Suzanne DePass went on to produce Motown 25. Jerry, you remember that, right?
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Honored. And where Michael did the famous moonwalk.
Yeah.
Motown 25. So Suzanne DePass, Lonesome Dove. She went on to become a television producer, film producer. But Mrs. Maxine Powell.
Wow.
I got the chance to meet Suzanne DePass a few years ago when Berry Gordy had the Motown the Musical came out. And I was at KBLX at that time. And so we were promoting the whole show. So we got a whole hour and a half with Berry inside of a room, not much bigger than a small bedroom. And you look over in the corner and then Suzanne DePass was there the whole time.
Wow.
Just hanging out.
Wow.
I went over and sat next to her. I said, you know what? I said, girl, do you know who you are? But she was just real quiet and just like you said, a lot of dignity about her. And I love that. So.
Yeah. And these are the women, just, you know, just for all my bro stars and my sis stars in our audience. Women, when I first started in radio, there were a handful of women. It was Vi Higginson for me at WBLS that I modeled my style of radio initially. And it took me 30 years to be able to thank her in person. An event where she was being honored. And I told her, for me, when they told me the honorees and they said, Vi Higginson, I was like, yes, where do I sign up? Okay, yeah. Tell this sister in person what she did for me as a woman in broadcasting. But we have to support the women in our industry because as you gentlemen who are on now, CJ, you know Big Russ, I know you know Big Russ, and Jerry, I know you're familiar because you've worked with some of the best women in the industry. Women are remarkable. We are resilient. We are nurturers, and we bring our men along and aside. We are behind when we need to be. We are in front. But women in the industry, I salute, especially right now. I want to say happy Black Music Month to everybody. I'm seeing this because if you've consumed, listened to Black music, it's not just for the songwriters and the singers and the producers and the engineers. It is for all of us who consume America's indigenous art form.
Come on. That's right.
Now, let's talk about Black Music Month and why you, since you brought it up. I know that in 1979, you worked with President Carter and your ex-husband, Kenny Gamble, and created Black Music Month. First of all, congrats for getting a 30-day month.
Yes.
And getting in the middle of the summer. None of that February Black History Month stuff. We got 30 days. Yeah. We didn't want 30. You didn't want 31. You want 30.
Here we go. So that was good. Here we go.
Yeah.
Every day we should be celebrating Black Music Month. And we do. Every day that we wake up and we're breathing, and that's everybody, not just Black folks. Mm. Everybody.
Right.
Black music is a universal language understood by the majority of the planet.
Yeah.
I know how to read numbers. It's difficult to find and quantify in numbers, but there's somebody somewhere at these record labels, they know, because they see their bottom line.
Oh, they know.
I want to shout out Ed Wright, who was the president of NATRA, the National Association of Television and Radio Artists, who along with Gamble and members of the Black Music Association established during Black Music Month. Okay. Penny and I were a couple at the time, but we worked on that. But years later, when I wrote President Bill Clinton asking him to host a reception at the White House, much like President Carter had June 7th, 1979, the White House said, President Carter didn't sign a proclamation. He declared June Black Music Month on the South Lawn of the White House with over 200 members of the PMA and the Black music industry. But he didn't sign the proclamation.
Oops.
So go get some legislation, come back, and we'll set you up with the president for a private meeting in the Oval Office. Well, that only took me a couple years. knocking on people's doors, I knew nothing at all about lobbying that I learned, and I'm passionate about Black music and culture.
Mm-hmm.
So it took a minute, but I enlisted a congressman, Shaka Pata, from Philadelphia,
mm-hmm.
and state senator, Arlen Specter, who was the Republican senator
mm-hmm.
from Pennsylvania. So I got him on both sides. I was like, write a letter to the president.
Yes.
Fellow congressional members.
Yeah.
Let's get this thing signed. I wrote the draft.
Wow.
Whereas of the language. And for me, what was important was that we recognize that Black music is, as I just mentioned, a multi-billion dollar entity.
Yes.
We don't necessarily think of it like that, but we should.
Yeah. Because
not just the feel good, it's money. Lots of money that's being made off of Black people's creative gifts and abilities.
Yeah. You're right. You are right. Bravo. Well, zoom in on that.
There we go. Oh, look at you. Look at you.
Amazing.
Look at that Black hair. Right.
Yeah.
this was my first of several meetings in the Oval Office with Bill Clinton.
Wow.
We talked about the Black music industry, Black music culture. And the second time I went, I took the Isley Brothers. And the president was a big fan of the Isley Brothers. And they signed guitar, all of the Isley Brothers, including the older ones that were Rudolph, that were not there. It was Ernie, Ronnie, his then wife, Angela Winbush,
mm-hmm.
Hicks, Sheila Eldridge, and myself. And
Sheila Eldridge, wow.
Yes, Sheila.
Sheila Eldridge.
My former partner.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Love Sheila.
Now, so with Black History Month, though, or Black Music Month, I'm saying, what do you, my two boys here, DJs, been doing it for a long time. Ryan Nicole is an artist. You got to see her perform someday. Tracy spent a lot of time with the labels and things like that. I was in radio and still help, you know, get other people gigs and all like that. What do you want us to do out here on the West Coast to make this happen even bigger? What can we do to promote Black Music Month?
Excellent question. You're doing it now. This is part of it. You are making people who are not aware that this is the 42nd anniversary of June Black Music Month. That's one thing. Using your social network, talking to family members, sitting with an elder, talking to them about the music they would listen to or the venues they would visit. Support music by streaming it, buying the merch of artists. Things are opening up again with the pandemic. Go hear live music. I've taken my mama to our neighborhood restaurant, jazz club called South, owned by two Black men, two brothers, the Bynum brothers. I've taken my mama twice in the last month to go hear live music and support the restaurant and the artist. These are some simple ways. My grandson has a little library in my living room of Black music related books, including one on his grandfather, Kenny Gamble, one of the architects of the Sound of Philadelphia, and the person who conceived of the idea of June Black Music Month. I just took it further. With his support and his knowledge, and I talked to Gamble this morning. He called me, and we relish when we hear about, I told him I saw Paul Williams, the president of ASCAP, hosted an event today with Timberland and Swiss Beats. It's on YouTube. On their channel, and I sent it to Gamble because Paul Williams opened up this event and he said June is Black Music Month. And so little by little, Comcast, different companies, most of the music companies, most of the record companies, and most Black stations have campaigns acknowledging June as Black Music Month. It is a period for us to put a spotlight of attention on music creators and music consumers. It's a celebration that continues beyond the month.
Indeed.
You know, Dyana, go ahead. I was going to say, Dyana, you're really pretty good at this. You should think about a career in radio. You're really pretty good at this, you know? I'm here for you.
For radio, huh?
I'm here for you. Dominus Ominus. Go ahead with it. Go ahead, Ryan.
Here in the Bay Area, we have been throwing an event. We started last year during the pandemic. Celebrating and honoring Black Music Month in particular. And the event's called Black Music Matters. We had one last year. It's become an annual. We're doing the same thing this year, featuring so many of the integral artists here in the Bay, here in Oakland in particular, celebrating not only the beauty and the like the intersections of Black music, whether it's Latin jazz, whether it's hip hop, gospel, so on and so forth, but also celebrating that nexus of the Black Power movement and the Black Arts movement with Black Music Month. So just really, you know, we get it here. We're so grateful for your advocacy and your lobbying, you know, for making sure that we, our people get our flowers.
Yeah, and you know, I love what you just said. It's when you ask about other ways that you in your area, in your community, can celebrate Black Music Month, concerts, live concerts, you know, highlighting the independent artists in the community and sharing with people how they can connect and buy their music and support. I'm big on supporting independent artists. My daughter is an independent artist. She's a single songwriter, Idea Gamble. Her father produced the album, you know, financed it, but she is still a solo independent artist. Mm-hmm. So supporting artists like yourself, Ryan Nicole, is important. Supporting organizations that support the arts.
Indeed.
Some people can write checks. Some people can volunteer. Everybody has a different capacity, but my request is that you do one thing, something that is going to support and nurture, show love to Black music. She deserves our love.
She deserves it. Yes.
I always like to tell people too that when the legends come back and start touring this summer, Al Green, you know, Stephanie Mills, all these folks have been around forever. Do not take them for granted because you don't know if they're going to be here next summer. So I always encourage people.
It's not just the legends. It's everybody. You have no idea.
Well, yeah, but I'm speaking specifically about the Legends because, you know, we haven't heard from Al Green. I haven't heard anything about Al Green in the last year and a half. So I'm hoping, is he good?
To somebody, you know, he still has his church, and my understanding is that he is still preaching and in Memphis. But to your point, I get it, and definitely to Big Russell's point, they have a pulse, and they about the music. They deserve our love and respect and support.
Right.
You know, when I get things from independent artists, I will go buy the music. I will go stream the music, whatever. Although streaming artists don't get paid hardly anything from streaming unless they're racking up numbers like Drake.
Right.
And our laws on the books. I'm very active in the Grammy organization, and we are perfectly flawed.
There you go.
But we have a very strong advocacy mission, and I've been there. I have gone. I am a living example of lobbying.
Yes.
I've even got some legislation to recognize our industry, our music, and culture. So I've been up there with the Grammy organization. Most of the copyrights that pertain to songwriting and other music-related things are antiquated from the 20th century.
Right.
Yes.
There's a modernization law that passed, I believe, last year. Laws that protect songwriters, independent artists. I mean, there's so much to do, but we have to keep pushing. We got to keep pushing until we get through.
Indeed.
I salute you in that because me being a former music publisher, you know, you want to see the creatives win. You want to see them get their maximum, you know, lion's share possible. Exactly. And see what's happening. You know, it's just heartbreaking. So thank you, you know, for going to bat, you know, for so many creatives, no matter what the genre or no matter what the age range, you are fighting, you know, for us in the totality, you know what I mean, of the survival of our music. So thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. You're welcome. And thank you, Tracy. And thank you all, because it's a collective thing. I'm just a very fearless. I've been like this my whole life. So I just had the drive. You know, I didn't know anything about lobbying, but I went up there and just, you know, had no fear about knocking on the door saying, look, Black music generates a lot of money.
Hello.
Your people. So hello, it's an export as well. So I worked on language to make sure that the congressional people and the senatorial people understood what I was saying. And when I enlisted the senator and the congressman, I was like, we have an economy, we have a creative economy in this city that generates tax money.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, money that helps pay your salary. Mm-hmm. So when Black music in economic terms, it becomes a different scenario.
Mm-hmm.
We appreciate the sound, we are the flavor, whatever we create, however we mix genres, however we make futuristic, whatever. Mm-hmm. We are the flavor. We should be compensated for our creativity, our ingenuity.
Yes.
I mean, right, CJ? CJ's back there pulling us down with the vibe. We are energy. We are whatever's in the center of our planet, we are that.
Nexus, maybe.
On, and we keep it on its axis.
Yes. You could arguably say that pop culture is America's biggest export.
I say that all the time.
And Black people, right or wrong, and all props to our allies, but Black people, we drive that. Everybody checks for what we do, and there's no level of compensation for that. We have careers in various aspects of it. And when we talk to kids, I know for myself, I try to talk to kids about a path on both sides of the microphone.
Mm-hmm.
You know, from being a songwriter to being a publicist to being a recording engineer to being, you know, to learning how to master. So there's so much love on. People are passionate about this, and so many of us don't see, or I can't sing and I can't dance, so I'm just going to buy the music, you know, and not really pursue these other avenues that are out there for them to contribute into this culture that they love.
Mm-hmm.
And so many others do that. Mm-hmm. And that's why when we talk to kids, we don't really talk about, you know, the rappers and the singers. We try to expose them to the full spectrum.
Right.
If you love it, let me show you what's out there for you.
The ecosystem.
Right.
Yeah, and what I like to, I'm sorry.
I was going to say, we should hear what the children are listening to. We should ask them. We should listen. We shouldn't do like maybe our parents did to us. Oh, that crazy loud music. No, what are you listening to?
Yeah.
you know, we should take some time to also engage, not just, like I said, we should definitely talk to our elders, but we should talk to our young people and find out what it is that they are absorbing.
I try to do it, but I can't go with the TikTok. I'm not on TikTok. I can't do it.
I'm on TikTok. Come on, Russ.
I can't get with it yet. I can't get with it.
I'm on TikTok too. DJ, I know you're not on TikTok.
No. Not on TikTok.
Come on, Russ. I'm on TikTok.
My daughter watches TikTok a lot and sends me stuff from time to time.
No, Tracy. No.
There he goes. You heard him. He said watches TikTok like it's KTVU. That's not how it works.
That's not how it works.
Okay.
That's not how it works.
Hey.
Look, say less, Russ. Say less.
To piggyback on what Russell said, when I talk to the young people, I always ask them, do you want to be rich or you want to be famous? And most of them want to be famous, and all the people, all the positions that Russell described will probably make you a lot more money than a lot of these artists that everybody knows their name.
And so learn
the whole business. There's a lot of ways you can make some money, and then if you want to, you'll have enough money to make your own record and sell it to your family. But even if you are an artist,
you need to know the business. You need to know. Yeah. We had an interesting situation with a brother. I'm not going to name his name, but he's become very successful. But he had no idea where his money was going in his contract. Who was, you know, who were the artist development representatives? Who was the, you know, where was his budget coming from? Where was his money, his video budget coming from? When he's on promo tour, when all he brings all his boys on tour with him, who's paying for all that?
Right.
You know, they had no idea. And we sat down, he pulled me to the side, he said, man, I need to talk to you. And we sat down for maybe 40 minutes and explained everything to him. And I'm really proud of him. I disagree with a lot of stuff he does right now, but I'm really proud of his longevity and how he's made his space, because he decided, and he got a chance. He got a second chance. He had one contract that didn't work out, and he got a second chance, and he made the most of it. And
okay, right.
I try to tell all these guys.
In addition to that, Russell, we have had the advantage of being in an area where independent music was always key.
Right.
And so we could tell people how not only to create it, but how to get it distributed, you know, how to get it manufactured, how to get it distributed, and how to, you know, create your own grassroots, you know, support system and tour. So I don't know. I think we need to be doing more and speaking in the schools. And I don't know, Jerry, we got to think about that, because we do have a vast, you know, array of knowledge here.
You know, I would love to. It's hard to get into the school, public schools, but there are some schools.
This is my lane, right?
That's okay.
Yes, music education is my lane. YMR Youth Movement Records was what we did. It was all about educating young people about the ecosystem of the music industry, getting them not from their rap dreams, but helping them understand what the broader landscape was and the ways that the dollar flows. And then helping them critically assess the media that they were consuming so that they could properly produce or be behind music that was that critically conscious. So this is what we do. But just call at your girl. Call my people. Have my people talk to your people. We'll work it out.
We have the balance of the creative, right? We have that part. And then we also were right here in Silicon Valley. So like Russell mentioned, you know, in terms of making money, you know, with your music, you could be supplying videos, you know, source music for video games. Right here in Silicon Valley, you know, you can also, you know, have obviously the whole tech space. So I just think we have a rich location. When the world opens up, Dyana, we have to have you come and speak on a panel out here, because I think this backdrop would be perfect for what you're doing.
That would be wonderful. And don't y'all wait in Oakland, hold the Soul Train record that you took from Philadelphia for the world's largest Soul Train.
The
line.
Longest song.
We did the Soul Train ride.
Y'all still holding. I produced that event with a few other people here in Philadelphia.
Wow.
And held that record for a minute. I was in Florence, Italy, and a sister, I can't recall her name, I was in a green room. And she came in and she was like, oh, I'm so excited. When I get back to Oakland, we're producing, we're taking the record away from Philadelphia. And I'm sitting there saying, and then I told her, I said, peace, I'm Dyana Williams. I actually produced. And I have a Guinness World Record in my living room.
I heard that.
So yeah, but you know, props to Oakland.
We did it. We did it.
Our homegrown Maze and Frankie Beverly out there.
Yes. We love it. Yeah.
on to a Philly homegrown group out there.
Yes.
And aren't y'all the home of Sly and the Family Stone?
Go on and tell it. Go on and tell our history. Mm-hmm. We listen. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Go on.
Yes.
MC Hammer, Tony, and Vogue, the Whispers, all kind of folks out this way. Hey, you're watching IRTS Live. You are listening to the beautiful sounds and the knowledgeable conversation we're having with Dyana Williams. I'm Jerry Dub. I'm your host. I got my friends with me, Russell, CJ, Tracy, and Ryan. We got a few more minutes with Ms. Williams. So I did want to touch on Unsung because I got a couple of friends. We have a couple of friends of the program that are also have done what you do on Unsung, D Minor, Damian Minor, and Dolores Thompson. And I understand you probably have never met them because I understand you guys do them at different points. But
well, and P. Frank Williams, producer.
Yes. So
absolutely does an amazing job of the music and the movement piece that he did recently.
Beautiful.
During the pandemic was pretty amazing. I am the unsung lady, Derek.
Yes, you are.
Out in the world, and then people walk. They say, you're the unsung lady. Never, very seldom the name, but it's all good because I, of course, am elated to have been involved with the show since 2008, the first season, and I just taped recently, and just the Jones Girls episode was that. But I was just recently approached by Mark Rowland, who I had the honor of co-exec producing the Teddy Pendergrass episode on the NAACP Image Award that season. And that was an honor when I was asked, you know, because I'm also a producer, a TV reporter, and then I went behind the scenes. And so I got a wonderful credit for that unsung, but I am still the proud unsung lady, an opportunity to talk about people who I came up with in radio, many of whom are friends. Mm-hmm. And so what happens when a living artist does an unsung, they submit a list to the producers of the ideal people that they would like to have in their episode. Mm-hmm. So I'll be sure, I mean, just a ton of artists, and then artists who, like in the case of the Jones Girls, they were signed to Gamble's label, and I came up with those girls.
Yeah.
Now, a couple of questions that folks would know. Is any of that scripted, or is that just everything that you're saying is right from here?
Everything is from here. Mm-hmm. It's not scripted. The producers will ask specific questions in areas like, what was your reaction when you heard It's a Love Thing? You know, well, I was on the air. It was a hotly requested song. And the video, everything. So, it is not scripted. But they have their questions in the direction of how they're going to edit. But, you know, you sit, you talk for about a half hour or more, depends. And there you go. And then you sit at home and you see it. And again, I'm the unsung lady with pride.
It's cool. You know, I get a chance to pay attention to see my friend do these things. And I was sitting here like this, the Phyllis Hyman one. I was
That was the first season, Russ.
I remember. I remember.
That was rough because, of course, I knew Phyllis was signed to Philadelphia International Records. So I socialized with her. I played her music on the radio. I hosted her Philly concert. Others, but that was a tough one to deal with my disorder subject matter.
In my mind, that was my first wife. In my mind, it didn't really work out that way. I tried to learn how to whistle, but I couldn't even get to where she was. In my mind, I was Stedman Hyman.
You didn't have to whistle. You do the hand bone while she whistles.
Oh, that's true. That's true.
Yeah. That's true.
She was a lovely woman, very intense, extremely dramatic, theatrical. Mm-hmm. She was statuesque, all kind of gorgeous. You know, lovely woman. Just we miss her. Yeah. I was listening to, I think it was Meet Me on the Moon or something. One of those recently. Like a voice unlike any other. We haven't heard anybody come close to sounding like Phyllis Hyman.
Not at all.
Will Downing did a cover of Meet Me on the Moon. And if I could have slapped him on the text, I would have, what you doing?
I dare you. There's certain songs you do not cover.
I love him for it though, because it meant that much to him that he wanted to cover it.
Yeah. Will Downing, a very dear friend of mine. I actually played his girlfriend on Lust, Love, and Lies, the audiobook album. I named the album, and I played his love interest, his girlfriend, and the other woman was his real life wife, Audrey Tudor Downing. So we laugh about it to this day, because I was like, okay, Audrey is the side chick, and I was the main street, like, to the curb, for his actual wife.
Well, like, we didn't know it before, you are officially now the most interesting woman in the world. Just on that story alone.
Right.
Dos Equis.
Yeah, thank you for always being so sensitive and thorough, you know, when recounting everything that has happened, you know, in each person's career. Not everyone has that. Not everyone possesses that type of, number one, the knowledge, the history. And then just you could tell that you have a pure admiration, you know, for the people that you're talking about, and it just resonates, you know, with what you're saying. So thank you for representing, you know, because those are very sensitive stories. And also, yeah, like Ryan said, shout out to P. Frank Williams for even creating that so that we can honor those that came before us.
Yeah.
I think Unsung is the best show on any Black television, any show. The best show ever.
And I love the fact that it has staying power. It started in 2008, and it's still going strong. And it's, you know, for me, it's the anchor of TV One. It really is. Original programming that came out of TV One, and it's still a very, very valuable asset to the network.
I like how I'm surprised when I watch it, because I look at the lineup. I don't want to watch Unsung Silk. I don't want to see that one, but I watch it and I learn something. So they really did. It's very cool the way they put it together.
It's like liner notes come to life.
What you say, T?
I said, don't act like you don't like Freak Me, Baby.
No.
There's the lights down. Oh, yeah.
It's like liner notes come to life, you know? Look, we're gonna get just a couple more minutes. We can't let you get away without hearing some of your input on some songs. So you sent us a list of a few artists that you particularly love. So if we can just play a little bit from CJ Flash and hear your first thing that comes to your mind, and let's have a little fun with some music on IRTS Live. Go ahead, CJ. Nice. Come on,
CJ. Yes. Oh, yes. Love the Jones Girls. They were backup singers for Diana Ross, and that's where Gamble first saw them and courted them to come sign at his label. I talked to Shirley Jones last week.
Wow.
The sisters, Brenda and Valerie, have transitioned, and their music, of course, lives on. That tune, written by my sister, Cynthia Biggs, one of the women songwriters at Philadelphia International. Linda Creed was another one, but the song was written by Cynthia Biggs. Dexter Wanzel produced it, and I think Gamble had some words in there, if I'm not mistaken. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, the album cover, Russ, CJ, we can't forget the album cover, where they look like they were in the desert, and regal, all kind of regal. Okay.
Yes.
And, Shirley Jones is still a friend of mine to this day. I was just in her Unsung, and with her sisters, and she and I are grandmothers together, and it's beautiful.
Oh,
nice.
Single, and I was a young mother, and we are now grandmothers together. So we sit on the phone and talk about our grandbabies. That's new generation. Yeah.
That was a good one, CJ. Give us another one.
Okay.
Now that you know,
come on, man.
How I feel about you. Don't let it go to your head, no. Don't let it go to your head, no.
No, no, no.
Now that you know I can't live without you. on the way. Don't let it go to your head, no, no.
Dyana, do you have some background singer in your life as well? Because you got all the moves now.
I tell you, Patti LaBelle, my good girlfriend, who was also signed to Philly International, told me to stick to talking on the radio. My face was so broken. And then, and then Gene Carn, who we just heard, chimed in on that. Jean is godmother to my oldest son, Khalif Gamble.
Oh, wow.
She was also present for the birth of my two other children, Gamble. Kenny Gamble and I have three children. And she was in the room, sitting to me, holding my hand. And she had already had three children. My dear girlfriend, when she first came to sign her contract at Philadelphia International, she invited me to come with her because I had a super crush on Kenny Gamble. We were friends. He knew nothing about my crush, but trust and believe, Ryan, he found out later.
He found out.
We got a 6.5-year-old grandbaby.
Did he find out? He found out.
Wow. I'm right fresh.
I love too. Okay, I got a couple of love songs and three babies and a grandchild out of it.
You did by yourself. Good job.
Okay. I think I'm just gonna nod my head and smile. Okay.
Yeah, we're talking. We got some talking.
Okay,
yeah,
I know.
That's just some Ryan, Tracy, and Dyana talk right there. So,
Leon A. Hoff, Kenny Gamble wrote that one. Don't let it go to your head. Huge hit for June.
It's a bang.
I call her Sarah. Her birth government name is Sarah.
Sarah
Russell.
and Gerald.
A few months ago, we did our own kind of version of Versus, and we did Philly International Versus. Was it Gamelin? Jamin Lewis, right?
Jamin Lewis.
I love, and I told you on the phone before we started the show, I love Philadelphia International music. I mean, just that was my heyday. That was my pocket. That still is. Lou Rawls, the OJs. Yes. You just name it. I just love that stuff, man. All the way back to Expressway to Your Heart, which they did. So I love the music. And so nothing but respect and love for Kenny Gamble. So, CJ, you got one more before we let this lovely lady go? One more?
You know I do.
You got what I need. You got what I want. Only you, baby, only you. You ain't never had nobody love me like you do. Ain't never had nobody.
Hold on, let me get my brush out to brush my chest hair. Hold on, Flash.
Taco Meat Tuesdays, brother.
Theodore Derice Pendergrass, aka Teddy Pendergrass. I called him Ted. He was my best male friend until his last breath. I took his widow, Joan Pendergrass, in Nashville last week for the grand opening of the National Museum of African American Music on Broadway. I want you all to go to blackmusicmuseum.org.
We'll be there
to check it out. But Teddy was my best friend. I think of him often. He pops into I May Be Someplace and hear his music. And that song, by the way, Only You, written by Kenny Gamble and Leon A. Hoff.
Wow.
Teddy was one of a kind. I don't think we'll see the likes of him. Tyrese has signed up for the film.
Oh, wow.
Directed by Lee Daniels. Mm-hmm. And Teddy handpicked Tyrese at the encouragement of Charlie Mack.
Wow.
And Teddy and Tyrese became so close that when Teddy was in the hospital the last 9 months of his life in intensive care, Ty flew in and slept in the room with Teddy.
Wow.
He was handpicked, and Teddy thought of him like a son. Wow. And I cannot wait to see what Tyrese does to that performing
with
Daniel's direction.
Yeah, so that's going to be powerful.
My brother, my good friend. So a lot of, you know, the first Black male artist to have 5 consecutive platinum albums in a row. Five. Yeah, and he was going to go into movies. That's where he was headed. How about the Teddy Pendergrass Celebrity Jeans?
Oh,
I know anything about that. Yeah, girl, I got a pair that probably will fit you.
Well, hang on. I'll send you my address.
Yeah. All I have to do is maybe put 3 fingers in that, Jerry, in those jeans.
Again, I have no comment on anything you just said. Yeah, I just.
But you know what, Dyana, thank you for giving the backstory of Tyrese was selected, because it just really makes me know that he is going to embody that role, to have had the privilege to have, you know, to have, you know, spent time with him, and you know, all of that is amazing. I feel like that might be a Jamie Foxx moment for Tyrese, like the Oscar worthy. I feel good about this.
Me too.
Just like Andra Day, look what happened to her. Sure. She had no previous acting experience.
Yeah.
At least Ty has some experience, and he's a singer.
Right.
And like I said, handpicked by Teddy. You know, I know we're coming up on the clock, but I just really want to take a moment to thank CJ for playing those 3 songs of my friends. Those are friends. In my home, around my children.
Yes.
Been in their home, around their children, family, not just because, you know, the label was owned by my ex, but family, because I love their music. I play their music. I go to their shows. Like I said, Jean Karn, honey, she done seen every part of me. But I want to thank Russ. Like I said, Russ and I share a name. Jerry, you know, your smooth voice, you could just call me later tonight and put me to sleep. Okay. Say Herbie Hancock in the background and just.
Well, okay. All righty then. Okay.
Well, all right.
Yeah, you go get that man beat down tonight.
We need to stop the show right now.
For what you so eloquently stated about artists. And Tracy, you know, you feel like a kindred soul. First of all, we like the same people. So you know, I am sure of it. And I'm super grateful to y'all for inviting me to have this opportunity to talk about what I love most, which is Black people and Black culture. Specifically Black music.
Yes. So, one final thought. We've got to make a movie about you starring Angela Bassett.
There you go.
Bassett. You can see her strutting up to being the going to Congress and trying to get that Black Music Month in. Angela Bassett could carry that out.
Yes, that is so sweet. Thank you, Jerry, for that thought. I mean, Erin Brockovich, all those kind of films.
Movie about you. There's definitely not the movie. Yeah. Well, thank you so much for joining us. And again, this has been a real thrill for all of us. If I can speak for us, and just thank you so much. And we'll stay in touch with you. We'll always be rooting for you. We're going to go to blackmusicmuseum.org. We're going to enjoy the rest of Black Music Month. And we're going to watch in every step you make on Unsung and everywhere else, because you're friend of the family now. Okay.
We love you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Tracy. All of the best. I'm on social media. They love me. Dyana Williams, all across all platforms.
Here we go. Pulling it up.
And happy Black Music Month.
Yes.
Bye now.
All right. Love you.
Thank you very much. Love you.
Bye-bye.
Peace.
Peace.
All right, everybody. Hey.
Whoa.
Wow.
That was great.
I didn't want to let her go.
I know.
Can't you see like Angela Bassett doing that when she's, you know, going up to Congress to try to get into the door?
It's got to be a firebrand. Whoever does it has to be a firebrand and warm and engaging and ready. I mean, she ready for everything. Got all the stories.
All right, so look, everybody that's watching out there, don't go away. We got a little bit more to show. We got some segments ready for you. We got a new Music Tuesday. We got a view from the DJ booth. We got a What's Your Jam. We got a video that we want to show you. And of course, we got entertainment news. We'll be right back in about a minute and 20 seconds to wrap it up.
IRTS Live is brought to you by United Players. It takes the hood to save the hood. Lifelong Medical Care, offering free vaccines for everyone 12 and over. Call Lifelong at 510-549-5454 or visit lifelongmedical.org. This episode is powered by plushlifemedia.com. Let us remix your digital presence. Hey, we've got gear. Visit IRTSshow.com for coffee cups, caps, t-shirts, and just added IRTS Live mouse pads and personal protective masks. Founded by our own Ryan Nicole, check out Haven, a cultural media production and distribution initiative for housing justice. Find out more at havenprojectoakland.com. Join DJs Big Russ and CJ Flash for the world-famous show live Fridays, noon to 4 Pacific. Catch them on the following social media platforms. And if you'd like to join us as a sponsor, please email us at info@irtsshow.com.
All right, you guys, Jerry will be on here in just a second, but we just wanted to shout out everyone that is watching us from YouTube, everyone that is watching us, obviously, from Facebook, from Twitter, and from Twitch. Thank you guys for your support. Make sure you share this with someone, because this is obviously some amazing, amazing content that people will learn a whole lot about. So I am now giving you Mr. Jerry Beth.
Well, that was smooth. That was real smooth.
Thank you.
You got to give it a time in his moment.
Since I've been blessed with being with Dyana Williams, I'm going to talk like this all the time. So tonight's What's Your Jam is featuring one of my girlfriends from not a girlfriend, but a friend who's a girl. I can't take two ass whoopings tonight. It's What's Your Jam with Robin Carter. We picked this one out, and you'll know why in just a moment. Go ahead and hit that for me, please. Hey, what's going on? What's going on? I'm Jerry Dove. I am the host of I Remember That Song and the host of IRTS Live. And tonight I'm your host for What's Your Jam. Got my man, Almighty CJ Flash with me. He's the music director. How you doing, Flash?
Absolutely fantastic, Jerry. How you, brother?
Good. See, I turned Flash into two word, two syllables, Flash.
I like that. I like that. Extended. That's the extended version.
The extended version, the 12-inch.
That's right.
Of CJ Flash, okay? Now, we have to be grammatically correct, because our guest tonight, Ms. Robin Carter, is a former dean for many years at Sacramento State. She just retired. She's an old school friend of mine from Atwater, Atwater, Atwater. Okay, we'll do that later. Mother of two, a traveler, a hiker. She's a 70s girl, loves her music. She's my friend. How you doing, Robin?
Hi, Jerry. Good to see you. And so, what's my jam?
Well, hold on.
You don't want to talk about that yet?
I'm going to ask you about that just a minute.
Okay. So you glad to be here. Good to see you again. And thank you for the shout out for Atwater.
And say hello to CJ Flash here too, right?
Hello, Jay. How are you?
Fantastic, Robin. How are you?
Good.
Okay, so,
good.
So really, really quickly, I mentioned that you were dean at Sacramento State for how long? And you just retired. And what's that like?
Well, I was there for 33 years. I wasn't a dean all that time, but I was there for 33 years. I guess I'm aging myself a bit.
That's all right.
And retirement feels really good. You know, the pandemic was, really rough. And it really made me really realize that, what did I really want to be doing with my time? Mm-hmm. And going to work every day wasn't it. And so it was a real revelation for me. And I made the decision to retire. I have not looked back since, and I am happy.
Well, I'm glad you were happy, and I'm glad that everything is working out fine, and I'm glad you were here, because I need to know. Now I'm going to get ready to ask you, because like I said, you travel a lot, you hike a lot, you're very active and everything like that. So what's that song that you need to hear when you get up in the morning, or you get up in the afternoon, you get up in the middle of the night? What's that song that makes you say, you know what, I'm ready to do something right now? Robin Carter, What's Your Jam?
My jam is by the OJs. For the Love of Money. Mm. And let me just tell you why.
Okay.
It is the song that I hear over the ages that makes me want to get up, get on the dance floor, dance. Not the lyrics so much. The lyrics are really important. There's an important message there. But because it really takes me back to a time in my life, I was coming of age. When that song came out, I had just graduated high school. I was going to Merced College, but I was preparing to go away to college. So it was this in-between time in my life where I was coming from being, you know, transitioning into being an adult. And we spent every out on the base, partying with the airmen, of course, because nobody parties like military guys, for sure. And that was the song that was on the airwaves all the time. And so I could just recall, I can even feel the beat. I can feel where we were. I can see who was there. I can imagine what I was wearing. I can almost feel the sweat when that song comes on. I really can. Okay. It is for sure.
That's a solid explanation to my question to you. Look, I'm Jerry Dell. That's CJ Flash. You've been listening to Robin Carter as she told you about her jam. We'll see you next time. It's another episode of What's Yo Jam. Robin was very specific there. She could feel the sweat on her nose. That was a good one. Thanks a lot. Again, anybody out there that wants to do a What's Your Jam, just hit me up. Hit me up. DM me. Call me up. Tell me why we should do it. I know CJ and Russ were out over the weekend. And they ran into a couple of folks that I'm going to get them to do one. Tomorrow, we're going to tape a couple more with one of your local television sports icons here. So that'll be a surprise. We'll get him on. And it's going to be a lot of fun. We'll keep it going, okay? Since it is Tuesday, that means it is New Music Tuesday. Ryan Nicole.
So last you got something week, that,
let me give you full.
I'm raring to go. Go ahead. My bad.
I know you are. Okay, Ryan Nicole, you have something that's going to be a song to remember.
I do. I think I do.
Okay.
All right. Are we ready?
Ready.
Yes. All right. Awesome. So last week we got to feature a song by Miss Roberta Flack, her rendition of What's Going On. And this week, we get to feature an homage to her work with Donny Hathaway, a song that I just absolutely love called Be Real Black for Me, with Lettucey redoing it with a brother named Brian Courtney Wilson, who is a beautiful gospel singer, gospel artist with an amazing voice. He doesn't get enough flowers, but I'm so glad that Lettucey has pulled him onto this song. Be Real Black for Me. They're doing this song in particular for Black Music Month. The acknowledgement of this particular song is just really special to me. My parents, this is the album that they got married to. And it has been a staple in my household. So I'm really grateful for this new generation rendition of it. And so, yeah, Be Real Black for Me, Brian Courtney Wilson featuring Lettucey for Black Music Month. Let's give it a listen.
Our time short and precious, your lips warm and luscious. You don't have to wear false charms when I wrap you in my hungry arms. Be real black for me. Be real black for me.
Your hair soft and crinkly, your body strong and stately. You don't have to search and roam, 'cause I got your love at home.
Be real black for me.
I like that. I like that a lot.
Lyrics. Oh my God, those lyrics. Yeah.
I like that.
Soul music.
That sounded real good. That's a good one there, Ryan.
That's a good combination. I probably would have never thought to you know, do.
Yeah, but I love it. Together. I agree. You know, Brian has that kind of like that scratchy velvet tone, which is funny to say, but the scratchy velvet tone of the Hathaway voice. He's got that quality, and Lettucey can do just about anything. So, yeah.
So did anybody get to see her at Sturm Grove over the weekend?
Or at Santa Clara?
On Instagram.
In Santa Clara. She was in Santa Clara. Also.
Yes, she was. She was out here.
It's funny you say that, because scratchy velvet is how I would describe that jacket he's got on.
I knew. I knew if I served it up, somebody would knock it out. Oh,
and you know what? I'm rubber, you're glue. Whatever you say.
I'd call that jacket Mo Better Blues. I like that.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you very
much. Yeah, it screams bleak, huh?
It does. It's bleak for sure. In a good way.
All right. So anyway, I know you did. For the record, you did not. You did not. Ryan put a toe in it. You didn't say nothing. CJ, I hear you down there, CJ. I like
I'm giving
it.
You love, man. I love it. Listen, bleak is fine, okay?
Hey, okay. Hold on now. That's the third ass whooping I'm going to get tonight. So.
Oh, Lord.
All right. So, look.
We don't want that shit.
I love you, Sherry.
What else? Okay, Russell, your turn. You know what? If I was producing the right way, I would have had your shot come up after the jam. But anyway, it's still going to work. So, Russell Gatewood, give us a view from the DJ booth.
Yes. So, in honor of Black Music Month and that we were celebrating Philadelphia International, we had an opportunity to play at the San Jose Jazz Fest a couple years ago. And the mighty, mighty OJs were on stage. And so I just turned to my right and took a shot.
Wow.
Eddie was glistening. So I take that shot.
That's the right one.
These two, man, Walter sounds just like the record. It's amazing how he's been able to keep his instrument so pure. I was dazzled by him as a kid because his speaking voice and his falsetto, I couldn't figure it all out. Because they would talk to him in interviews. Mm-hmm. When you see them on the Lou Rawls telethon or something, you see him talking, and then he's hitting all those high notes. And I also, one thing I wanted to talk about, we just had the beautiful Dyana Williams on.
Yes.
And the song, the OJ song, Darling, Darling Baby, mm-hmm. was written mm-hmm. for her.
Yes. Oh, we slid that in on the but we were too busy cooking and giggling. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But yeah, she said that.
Come on, now that's a dedication of all dedication.
Okay,
yo,
my
daughter. I wonder. You're going to play a little bit now, Flash.
Now you know I got to now.
Oh no.
You're my darling, darling baby. You're my darling, darling love. You're my darling, darling baby. I said you're everything I ever hoped for in a woman. And as long as I may live.
Ooh, you're mine, darling, darling.
And they have a special grandchild.
Very special lady.
That's the way to get your crush, you know, dealt with. I like that.
Did you say dealt with?
Yeah, you know you want to say
that part. Very special lady.
Oh,
These guys, they still got it. Giving you.
Yeah. I'm going to do my best to give it to you.
Ooh, you're my.
Come on.
We in there. We having a good time. Come on.
That I was at that show too, and the guys were great and on stage. Yeah. It was one of them things where they were on stage and the light was on, but boy, they hobbled off that stage, boy.
Yeah.
Ooh, their feet hurt, their back hurt.
Oh, mm-hmm. Those shoes look a little tight.
They do look tight.
Yeah, those were not capizios.
Those weren't easy spirits.
You There is no collab with Skechers and Stacey Adams.
Maybe this summer, when they come out this summer,
they should. Yeah.
They still sound like you said. They sounded great, man.
They do. They sound. Now I did hear that they're not touring anymore. I did hear that.
Oh, what?
Yes. Yeah, I did hear that. They are not no longer touring.
Last couple of years ago was the last go round.
Wow, how lucky were we that we were at that show?
Yes. You were there too. That's right.
Him up on a little chair or something. You know, they ain't even got to do dance moves.
Tracy trying to wheel people out on the stage.
Step by step.
Come on, Jerry.
Step by step. Now, the OJs, again, I was telling Dyana, I mean, I was all about Philly International in my 70s, in the 70s. And the OJs, Teddy, they were dominating the 70s, man. And just one album after another. Just not just songs, but albums. Mm-hmm. And it was just amazing. It was amazing.
Was Natural Man, was that Philly International?
No, that was MGM. That was Natural Man was MGM. He later he came into the fold later.
He came in with You'll Never Find. That was his first big hit with them. Yeah.
Oh, it's Spring Again and stuff.
It's Spring Again.
All right, that was a good one, Russ. That's a good one. So Tracy, what you got for entertainment news this week?
Listen, there's just a few little things that I wanted to highlight. come on, y'all have it to me?
Yeah, girl.
No, let me say this. You know how you watch Charles Barkley and they always give Charles a hard time because he says, well, first thing, and he says the first thing about 10 times. Yes. Whenever you start, say, well, listen. That's your go-to thing. Listen.
Matches. Listen.
Listen, that's the drum roll. Come on, that's the drum roll.
All right. Oh, you go ahead.
This week, you know, we wanted to touch on Grammys. I know Lady Dyana spoke about it. And so it's good to know that we have some people of color that have been appointed in some decision-making positions. So the Recording Academy names of Alicia Butterfield Jones. Okay. Jones in the case. There's a brother somewhere. And Daniel Spenya are co-presidents, and this will be effective as of August 16th.
Wow.
So I'm very, very excited to see what changes they'll make within that organization, you know, and hopefully they will complement, you know, Black music and people of color, most definitely. So congratulations to them. And then Janelle Monae, she signed a global deal with Sony Music Publishing. So go ahead. And this picture just gave me life. So I just said, go ahead and add that in there. So congratulations to her. And then this Saturday, you guys, I don't know if everyone's excited, but Bow Wow. Well, they call him Bow, I guess, because he's a member of the band now.
Yeah.
Bow Wow and Soulja Boy. So I'm like, you. Come on, right, guys.
I'm Superman. I'll be you. I might be busy that night.
That show's gonna be 15 minutes long, Jerry. You can handle it.
Yeah.
We're gonna be in and out of it.
It's just called Verse.
But I know that this will be full of memes and full of wonderful things on the internet. I cannot wait to see. So those that are interested, you know,
I want to see the after show. How are they going to parody this?
Shout out to Avion.
Yes,
I got it. I want to see that.
I can't wait.
This is the first one where the after show is going to get more viewers.
We love you, Timbaland.
And
shout out to Avion. It's Spice. Shout out to everybody.
I cannot wait.
Yeah. But listen, you guys, I just wanted to highlight this. I know I talked about it last week, but I'm talking about it again.
Talk about it.
So her album is in stores right now. Mm-hmm. And I have been just standing over it. I think it's really a good, beautiful body of work. And so make sure you guys go and download that, stream that, however it is that you get your music. Make sure you support her. And then there's one song in particular that has just been ringing in my head. Mm. And I was just going to play a little clip of that video with your permission.
Please,
please. Lucky I ain't crazy, just a little maybe. Ooh, that's how you made me. Won't you ever forget that you're lucky. Lucky I got eyes for you, nobody could block the view. You know I got options too. Lucky that I ain't get my payback. Lucky we go way back. Lucky that I'm way back. It's funny. It's funny now you want it.
Yeah.
Yo, you peeped the shirt?
I know you were looking.
I peeped the shirt. I'm proud of her, man. I'm still rocking Damage like it was
too.
I heard it for the first time.
And
maybe it's because of where they got the track from.
Right.
But dude,
yeah,
Damage.
I really can't catch up. I'm still on the first mixtape, to be quite honest. Like the first album drop. Yeah, because she's got hitters and there's such a wonderfulness to her tone. Nothing plays out. She's on point all the way.
Yeah, the stuff with Khaled is cool. Mm-hmm. I was, you know, the language kind of brought me back a little bit, but I was like, okay, I'm rolling with it. And still, that joint with her and Michelle on Glassworth's Black Radio record.
Yes, yes.
Damn!
Yes.
Damn!
Yeah.
I mean, what an amazing person to represent the Bay. You know what I mean? I'm so proud of her. But like I said, it's been in heavy rotation in my ear. And now with Ryan's suggestion, that's going to be in rotation. So I love it. Come on. And if anybody that is watching us, you know, definitely drop some stuff in the comments of whoever you are listening to, whoever's in, you know, your iPod or your however, drop it in the comments. We want to know what you're listening to.
You said iPod.
DJ said iPod.
That's in your tape deck, the CD player.
Well, I was gonna ask if it was on vinyl or a CD because
you know, it's in your vinyl.
She probably would though, right?
It probably is.
Yeah.
I got $35 for an album. Yeah.
Can I tag your entertainment news real quick, Tracy? I'm reluctant to do this, but I gotta do this.
Okay.
The Olympics coming up.
Yes.
And we are taking land, sea, and air and court.
Yes,
the women on in every sport right now are slaying. I just want to shout out Sha'Carri Richardson.
Yes.
The sister in the water. I can't even remember Simone Biles. There's a wrestling sister. There's just it's gonna be a crazy wild Tokyo 2021.
It's going
down. Yeah. And
there's a nice video of the Richardson young lady going up into the stands to hug her grandmother.
It's so beautiful.
Wasn't that really beautiful?
She does. It's so beautiful.
And as former track stars, you and I, Ryan, we know about the...
We know a thing, too.
I just wish I had that picture of me going over the hurdles right now, you know, so you can pop that up. So
we'll have to pull it up.
I got one right here. Hold on, let me put it up. It looks like Wile E. Coyote, but hold on.
Oh, Lord.
Pull it up, Russ.
You're just a shot putter. You jealous. You're a shot putter.
I am, yes. But I got my block though.
That's actually a good idea that with Ryan's history, you know, with her being embedded in sports and things like that, if there is a major sports highlight, Ryan, I think you need to add that to your segment, ma'am. Well,
I will, because we can talk about them Nets getting shut down. Okay. Right. We can talk about how perhaps LeBron might be the GOAT, perhaps.
We can talk about how homeboy from Atlanta is not Steph Curry. He's shooting about 43% from the field,
exactly.
Like 30, Trey. Low 30s from the 3 points. So hold on, everybody.
Trey.
It's just Trey. He is good.
Oh, he's good.
He is good. He's good. He is good. I really don't get the whole follicle game, but he is good.
Yeah.
He needs to fade. He does.
His hair is fluffy. It's very fluffy.
Yeah. It's like a chia pet.
He needs a product, but that's okay. Trey, we like you.
He said some product.
He needs some product.
lay it down.
Tracy, I'm down for a sports segment. I am.
Between you and Russ, I think that would be a dope contribution.
I love sports more than I love music, Tracy. I really do. I love sports more than I love music. So we can all chip in on that.
About a song that I discovered out of nowhere.
What's that?
That it's actually has Daryl Anders' Agape Soul is on this record.
What?
A song called Kiss of Freedom. I bounced on CJ the other day.
Oh my God.
Man, this song is so good. It's JP. Well, I can't think of the name of the group. JP and the. I have to figure out the whole thing.
We'll find it.
What's it called again?
Kiss of Freedom.
Kiss of Freedom.
Kiss of Freedom. Okay.
Send it to me now, Russ, and I'll play it before we leave.
Yeah.
All right. All right. So look, while we're talking here, while we're wrapping up.
JD's Time Machine.
There you go.
All right, Tracy, tell me what's going
on. She's on the Googles, man. They're right to be on the Googles now.
She's the Google girl. Tracy, tell us what's going on with Plush Life Media. Go ahead.
Oh, man. Listen, a lot of things going on. You know, I'm very excited to have a discussion with Damien Hall tomorrow from Guy.
Wow.
So I'll be on Clubhouse. We'll have a discussion. We're just getting him, you know, set up on Clubhouse. But at the same time, you know, I have questions about Guy. So we will be talking about that. Mm-hmm. And
are you going to wear your tour jacket?
Well, see, I think the sleeve might fit, but you know,
drape it over your shoulders, it'll be
right. So, I might not rock that, but and then next week, I'm very, very excited, and which I'll elaborate on more. But next week, I'm going to be sitting down talking to the CEO of Jesse Collins Entertainment.
Okay.
So I'm very, very happy to be talking to him, and I'm doing that in collaboration with the university, and so more details to follow, and promotional materials to be sent out on all of my social media, which is at Plush Life Media. So I'm excited about that.
Okay. You know what I'm excited about too? CJ, get that blip, blip, blip ready. That blip, blip, blip.
Oh, okay, go ahead.
She has reached 10,000 IG followers.
Yeah.
I saw yesterday it was like 9,998. I said, how can I be the 10,000? And then I saw today she hit 10K. And we were talking earlier. I said, I'm gonna mention it. She said, well, hold on, in case somebody drop out, I don't be 9,999.
You have that D Nice picture?
I need a picture, right?
Yeah, you need a nice picture.
Yeah, you messing
around. So congratulations to you, Tracy. I know that you don't even know the work that it takes to get 10,000 people to hit this button.
Organic.
She is not chasing anybody.
No microwave ovens.
Slow cook.
So very proud.
Tracy crock pot. Anderson.
Slow cook Anderson.
Slow cook Anderson.
So,
Tracy, Oxtail Anderson.
Wait, what did you say, Ryan?
Tracy, Oxtail Anderson.
Oxtail's falling off the bone, Anderson. Come on.
All right, Ryan Nicole, what you got going on? I know you're always busy. What you got?
No, I'm super busy. I just want to continue to give Tracy her flowers. That is big. That is major.
Yes.
You know, to get that 10K and that legitimate 10K. So your IG Clubhouse social media game is goals. Anybody who needs to know how to do this thing, just follow sis. She's doing it. I wish I had the time in the day, but you're killing the game. This weekend, what am I doing? Black Music Matters is this weekend. So this is the second annual. Last year, we took a real risk, but made a Black Music Matters event happen at the EDOF Memorial Bandstand at Lake Merritt. And we had about 300 people, and we did the socially distant, and we had COVID testing, and we had, you know, all the stuff out there. This year, thankfully, the world is open again, and we can maybe sit next to each other. But we are having the Black Music Matters back at the bandstand at Lake Merritt. It's not where all the stuff happens at Lake Merritt. It's interior to Lake Merritt. So if you're by Fairyland, mm-hmm. you go inside, and it's the historical bandstand, and it's meant for music. And we were just really excited to reinvigorate that space last year, and really excited to bring it back. Kev Choice is playing. Kev Choice is producing this thing. Black London, his group. There's so many people.
I love that group.
Yeah.
So many people. We've got Latin Jazz All-Stars that are coming out. We've got some gospel music coming out. We've got, of course, hip-hop. We've got representation from the young and the old. There will be some, we have a partnership with Umeda Health. So if you have not been vaccinated yet, you can come out to Black Music Matters and get vaccinated out there. And COVID tested and all of that. But we'll be just having a good time in the sunshine on Saturday from noon to seven. So come on out. I'm hosting. I was really glad to be there.
Beautiful. Love it. CJ Flash and Big Russ, I know you guys were out working last weekend. What you got going on this weekend?
It felt good. We were outside. Man. We were outside with the peoples. It felt good. Man. I had, you know, we've been doing our thing online, but wow, there's something about that energy that you get from people. Mm-hmm. It was a lot of fun. A lot of fun. Doing the Juneteenth celebration at Laney College, that was cool. And then the grand opening of the outdoor skate rink at Liberation Park, that was crazy fun. These people have just, everybody's fun. Picking up a hammer to make this thing happen. They put it together. It's gonna be bigger and better this Sunday. It's so fun. I like seeing CJ in his element because he is like the Bob Barker of roller skating. this dude,
he does, you know, feel some kind of way about roller skating, don't he?
Yeah, he does, man. He loves it, man, and he and it shows in the way that he interacts with people and the music. And I'm just following his lead when it comes to that. It's a lot of fun. So we do internet on Friday. With the extravaganza on Fridays.
Hold on, Ryan. Do that again, Ryan.
To a bunch, get extravaganza. So that's 12 to 4 on Fridays on Mixcloud, twitch.tv, Periscope via Twitter. Facebook Live, hotdogwater.com, Instagram Live, 4 hours. Flash is just ridiculous on the tables. And just, it's four turntables, two mixers, two microphones, and you. We're just having fun. Yes. Last week, the slow jam battle was slow songs with talking in the beginning.
Did you miss me over the weekend?
I had a giant song back in the day.
So you had to play Love Jones, right?
No.
What's happening, baby? Did you miss me over the weekend?
No, I didn't play that one. That's a good one. Played Main Ingredient. We played Floetry.
Yes.
Played Bobby Womack.
I got you.
This is why people are skating?
No.
On Friday.
That's all right. But we do play slow songs. That we do play, you know, lower tempo songs for, you know, the couple skate and backwards skate. And, matter of fact, we started off, we had a moment. We started it off with Portuguese Love, this version of Portuguese Love that I found.
Fire and Desire.
I'm sorry, Fire and Desire. It's a 10-minute version that is very rare. It's everything's isolated. And we started the evening off with that. We sound checked with that. Basically, it was pretty cool.
Oh my!
Wow. All right, well, nice. That's great. Flash, you gonna want to add anything to any of that?
Yeah. Speaking of roller skating, this is going to be a classic. I'm guaranteeing at some point this is going to be a roller skate classic. Okay. That song that Russ just sent me.
My life to understand, missing things I never knew. Higher mountains, deeper waters, I have dreamed I'd make it through. Till you gave me the kiss of freedom, fill me with the breath of life, took me to the garden.
That's nice, man. That's our boy Daryl on there.
Yeah, Daryl's on there playing bass. It's fly. I like it a lot.
I like that. I'm gonna have to hit him up about that. So look, I got one thing for you guys. Know that you make fun of these mouse pads I put out there, but they sold out.
Yes,
so
they did.
I created a new one.
Nice.
Hit that horn again. Hit that horn. Yeah. That's the second edition of the Mouse Pad, which sold out. I did not have to give them all away. They sold out. So I said, let me do that, man. So I'm gonna make them like collector's items. I'm making like baseball cards. You have the first one, you got the second edition, what you got, you know? So that's what I'm gonna do.
Baseball cards. Wow. Yes.
Who makes those things? Ronco?
No. Jesus. This has been fun. Yeah. We had a great guest. Dyana Williams was on, the godmother of Black music. Celebrate Black Music Month, everybody. Go to what was it? It's the blackmusicmuseum.org. Listen to the fellas on Friday. Check out Tracy tomorrow with Damien Hall, 10,002.
Nice.
Watch Ryan Nicole doing her thing over the weekend. And buy some mouse pads. We'll see you next time with another edition of IRTS Live. Peace.
Bye, y'all. Bye, everybody.
IRTS Live is brought to you by United Players. It takes the hood to save the hood. Lifelong Medical Care, offering free vaccines for everyone 12 and over. Call Lifelong at 510-549-5454 or visit lifelongmedical.org. This episode is powered by plushlifemedia.com. Let us remix your digital presence. Hey, we've got gear. Visit IRTSshow.com for coffee cups, caps, t-shirts, and just added IRTS Live mouse pads and personal protective masks. Founded by our own Ryan Nicole, check out Haven, a cultural media production and distribution initiative for housing justice. Find out more at havenprojectoakland.com. Join DJs Big Russ and CJ Flash for the world-famous show live Fridays, noon to 4 Pacific. Catch them on the following social media platforms. And if you'd like to join us as a sponsor, please email us at info@irtsshow.com.